you have some member of the public that needs to watch that? Would you like to make any comments?
Well, I can tell you, I am a physical therapist. I've been one for 40 years. I work in Santa Rosa. I live in Sonoma. I got your email about a month or 6 weeks ago, I can't remember, and you discussed the new programs, particularly my interest is pain management. And when I saw that, I wanted to come and hear what you were offering the public, offering, you know, the clientele that we have, and if it was appropriate to offer services. But I, you know, see what you're talking about. And that's how I came to be here. But I am a resident of Sonoma.
Well, welcome.
Thank you.
And I think we'll probably refer you. I don't think there's pain management on the agenda today.
Yeah, I thought there was, but that's okay. I still want to be here.
Yeah, and you want to stay, and maybe Kelly,
yeah,
and Hachi Kelly, or
somebody can
get you in touch with someone.
Wow, that would be great.
So the man behind you probably will be
answering
questions.
Okay. Hi, Bob.
Thank you very much. What's your name?
Janet
Schoenberg. Good. Thank you, Janet. Since there's no other public comment, we have a consent calendar. Can I get a motion to approve? And if there are any questions or comments, get that back.
So
second.
Any comments or changes, suggestions? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, tonight we are swearing in, or re-swearing in and swearing in two board members, myself and Dr. Lunardi. Asked Bill to do the honors. So I think we're going to come over to you, New Bill. We're going to stand for this, right?
Yeah.
Because it's going to hurt.
You know, there's no compensation for this position. There's no healthcare provider.
He's a doctor.
But we'll hold this and we'll. All right, so the oath of office. So I'll start out and you can give your seat each of you. You can hand up your hold up your right hand. So I,
Michael Lunardi,
Joshua Runner,
do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
Do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties upon which I am about to enter.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge the duties upon which I am about to enter.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Four more years. Okay. Thank you, Bill, for doing that. Next order of business is the election of officers, and what I would like to do is okay. I would like to propose and move a slate of officers for the coming year. And if anybody would like to comment on those or object, if not, we'll vote for a second and go forward. This is going to feel really weird, but I'm going to propose that I get to be board chair again next year. It feels a little odd to do that, but I'm going to go, see how that flies. And I'm going to propose that Jane is our first vice chair, that Dr. Martin, our newest board member, becomes our second vice chair. Sharon continues on as our treasurer, and Bill is going to continue on as our secretary. Kelly is second. And any comments, questions, changes?
Sounds excellent.
All in favor?
Aye.
Great. I'd also like to propose and move a slate of board committee assignments for the coming year. And these will sound very familiar for finance. Sharon, I want you to continue, if you would, as chair of finance, and I'd like to be the second board seat on that. For quality, we would like to suggest and recommend that you become and continue to be the chair there, and that Captain Marty, you actually are perfectly suited to continue in that role. To take that role in quality, I hope you will like that. For governance, we lost our chair in Peter, and so I've asked Bill, you'll chair the governance committee, and I will sit with Bill on that on an as-needed basis. And so can I get a second on that, and then we'll entertain any comments?
Second.
Ooh, excitement. Any comments or questions? Surprises. All in favor?
Aye.
Great. Okay. The 2019 board work plan, which is a package. On there. Get that one on up.
So I think the question is, and Shelby, you are also going to ask, but
So are there others from this list, or who aren't on this list, that we would like to see have come and talk to the board?
I'm losing a name. The lady who came and talked to us in this arena that I invited, who was, who put in, had in the past been the director of medicine for the Robert Public Health Center.
Senator.
I think it was very, she lives here.
Does she live in Sonoma?
Oh, cool. So I think that would be one to add to the list. I thought that was a very helpful discussion.
Yes, it was down here?
So it's like, yeah, yes.
Okay.
I think especially with the new governor, she might have some insights in addition to the others.
And just coordinate that. Okay. I don't think we have to approve this, do we? This is just an FYI. Good. Terry, I think you are on. And Terry is here to give us an update on cancer support. She also sings and dances.
Yes, she does.
We are going away then.
Such a hint.
Such a good old tapping for us.
First of all, I want to thank you for inviting me to come and speak and give you an update about what Cancer Support Sonoma is doing. I want to give a special thanks to Dave and his team for putting up with me and putting up with us as we did this transition and probably hung on just a little bit longer than they wanted. His team was great and very supportive, so I want to thank you, Dave, so much for that. A lot has happened since we left the hospital. I was called in December of last year by Pam Koppel, who said, we're looking for some more providers, heard that you might be interested, and I'd like to tell you about our program. So I met with Pam, and she told me what Cancer Support Sonoma did, and that was provided integrative complementary care to people diagnosed with cancer. I lost my mother, my father, my sister, two aunts, and three uncles from cancer. So my heart was just filled with, what can I do? So I said I would love to step up. I'm a licensed acupuncturist and an Ayurveda practitioner. I ran a clinic, an integrated clinic in Seattle for 10 years, so I was ready to start. What Pam didn't tell me was that she was leaving and was living in Los Angeles. And by the way, we are happy to look for another place to be doing our work. So I said, I like challenges. And this is really a wonderful program. What can I do? And so I took it on. And it's been a very challenging year. October, I think, was when we left. Is that right, Dave? When cancer support left? I didn't go on until December, so it was around October. Two of our clients were saying, what can we do? We don't want this program to go away. What can we do? So they took on building our website and getting that going. One said she would do communications for us, and then it was great. Okay, that's done. What's next? What's my space? One of our volunteers, Susan Murray, who's been fantastic, found us a place with Dr. Elliot Carter. He wasn't in his office, he's a chiropractor in the community, and so he let us use his office on Fridays. If any of you have ever had chiropractic care, the tables are this wide. We put mattresses on top of them, and we did our body work, acupuncture, and oncology massage on those tables, and we made it work. We kept our community together. That was a challenge. And then I was invited by Celia to Girl Talk. So we went to the hospital's presentation on Girl Talk, it was on breast health, and I met Dr. Alexis Alexandrides doing her talk on breast health, and I met, and we meet her. We talked after the program, and I said, we're looking for space, tell me about what you're doing. And it just, the next day I went and looked at her space, It took us a few months to get things going. We approached the Rotary and said, we found some space we think we can move into, but it needs a lot of work. What can you do to help us? Rotary gave us a grant of $1,500. We had paint donated. We had some carpet pieces donated. We had a contractor in the community who donated his time to take down a wall and put up a door so we can make another room. And we ended up with this lovely space with a great person to share it with Dr. Alexis, and we have three treatment rooms now. Some of you may have come to our open house. We did have a good showing from the hospital, so that was fantastic. And we are running the clinic every Friday with three practitioners, Monday, half day, Wednesday, or Tuesday or Thursday. Some other day is a half day, depending on when we can see it. What would be helpful is we would like to rent the rooms out, three treatment rooms, 2 to 3 days a week to help us with the rent. We've tried a few people. We have one person that's part-time, but that's something that we really want to secure in the next year, a regular renter to help defer that cost. In March, we received a grant from to celebrate Life Breast Cancer Foundation for $10,000. That got us on our way. And then in April, we finished up all our reconstruction of the facility and opened our doors May 1 to see clients. So Dr. Carter, we were only supposed to be there a couple months, let us extend our stay, much like Dave did, extend our stay at his place for 1 day a week. We had promptly opened up our doors for 2 days a week in May. The end of May, we received our 501c3 status, became an official nonprofit. And then in June, we received a $20,000 grant from Impact 100. That was the most amazing thing I've ever been to. If you're not familiar, no one knows who wins until you're sitting in that room with 300 plus people, primarily women, with this energy just waiting to hear the announcement. And it's fabulous. When that started, so that was in June that we received that. July, we opened our first bank account, finally, Dave. And then in August, everything got shifted over to us managing all of our funds from the Sonoma Valley Hospital Foundation. October, the end of September, we finished the final draft on the research project, which brought this whole thing together and us to the hospital. It is in the final review at UCSF with Dr. Druva. We have identified four journals that we're gonna try to get it published. Also in September, we got a new board. So we have a member from our client member. We have two of our providers who have been with the program day one. We have a breast cancer survivor. We have a Rotary representative, and Dr. Alexis is our physician on our board. We've had three board meetings since we got our board together, October, November, December. And one of the first things was, let's have an open house. Let's make sure everybody knows we're here. We move, we're no longer at the hospital. And what started out as this small thing that we were hoping to get about 50 people turned out to be over 125 people showed up and supported us. We made $5,000 on our silent auction and had really great food and wine that was donated. In November, we started a project. We were trying to figure out what kind of fundraising activities we could do. So we had one of our clients and her friend developed a video for us on what we call a friendraiser. And it basically, it's on our website if you want to look at it, it's telling people how you can invite some friends who have nice thick checkbooks to your home for some drink and learn about Cancer Support Sonoma. It turned out so well. It was really, it was a lot of time because I've never been involved in the whole video process, so it's many, many hours, and editors, I give them a lot of credit because it turned out great, so I welcome you to look at that. Where we are right now is we are looking at what's next for us. We know we can't stay idle just doing the same wonderful, fantastic thing we're doing. So for 2019, we're looking at expanding our program. The thing that kept coming up over and over with the clients that I was seeing and through our focus groups was that we needed to do more for the caregivers. So some of the practitioners, we were just seeing people for free because they were stressed out. So we want to expand our programs to provide these same therapies, massage, what have you, to the caregivers. We also see a need for caregiver support group. Our support groups are going great with people who are going through this journey, but the families are really, it's all different levels from children's to spouses. So we would like to do a couple support groups for the client and the family. We identified an unmet need in the community, especially in the Sonoma Valley, and it's with men. Men who are diagnosed with cancer, we have like 3 men who come to our clients, and we just lost one of them this last year with pancreatic cancer. So we know they're out there, and we want them to know that we're here. So that's one, and then the other is with the Spanish-speaking population. Those are our expansion groups. We are going to put on a series of classes for cancer prevention. We want to do 4 this next year, and Dr. Alexis will be a presenter on allopathic approach. Natalie is going to do one on the psychosocial aspect of it. Dr. Danielle, who's our naturopath, is going to talk about supplements and other forms of healthcare for cancer diagnosis. And I'm going to do a class on healing foods, food as medicine, and a little cooking class. So those are the 4 classes that we're looking at doing this next year. Right now we're in the process of applying for the Impact 100 along with everyone else in the community. This one is for their one-time 10-year anniversary $50,000 grant. So we're applying for that, and we're applying again to Celebrate Life. We have grants out to Genentech, and The Secret will be out here. You'll be the first to hear our fundraiser for this coming year, our annual fundraiser, is a farm-to-table dinner. So you'll hear more about that as we progress. And we hope to have another open house to get more people there in the spring, which is going to be a plant and herb sale. So at our place, which is, so it seems like it would be a good community. Any questions? We've got a lot in the last year.
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
How much do you need to raise? Sorry.
How much do we need? Well, I wouldn't mind being paid.
Yeah.
So I have worked for the last year without a salary, doing what I'm doing. We have 8 volunteers. So, you know, we have probably, we're looking at $150,000 is what we're trying, going to try to do.
Per year?
Per year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Providing genomics on your patients, with your family history, thought you might be interested in patients that you see in your clinic, in terms of making sure that the family members know the genetics of your disease and make sure they're screened properly.
This is
one of the problems we see where the information is not given to family members. You should be screened for this cancer at a much earlier age.
And that's one of the things where it's so amazing having Dr. Alexis with us. And that's part of what our doctors are doing in the office, our naturopath and Dr. Alexis. But that's something I think that would be really helpful to add as part of our expansion program. Thank you.
Karen, how many clients? How many visits?
We had 1,200 total visits last year, therapy visits.
And is that still on the sliding scale? Do they have the, so they still pay whatever it is?
Yeah, and you know what was really interesting this year when we were looking at that sliding fee scale? Is we had a handful of people who said, no, I can afford it, I want to pay the full price, which was fantastic. You know, we hadn't seen that very much before, and this year we did, so that was fantastic. And then we had some people who absolutely could pay nothing, you know. The other thing, Rotary came through with that as well. Anyone who was a fire victim, they gave them a lump sum of $1,000 for treatments with us. So that was fantastic. The other one who was a new funder for us, which is on a client-by-client basis, is the Yulani Fund, if you're not familiar with them. She was a family physician in San Francisco, living in Santa Cruz, and she died of breast cancer, and they started this foundation. And they give money to, the way the program works is they're almost a clearinghouse, so if someone is in need, you can go to your acupuncturist or your massage person, and they give it to that provider. But since we are a group of providers, they give that to us, and they can see any one of our providers. And I went and volunteered to their big fundraiser, and got to meet them and let them know how much our clients appreciate it. And they've come through for probably 10 clients this year. So their share of our sliding fee scale is covered. So our patient assistant counts pays for the part, and then the Yulani Fund pays for theirs. And they gave to one of our clients 3 times because she couldn't get well enough to get her operation. So while she was in that interim period, they still came through.
Sorry. Going back to Jane's question,
yes.
Apart from the number of visits, how many discrete patients have you seen?
We saw 50 individual clients.
Right. Any sense of the number of cancer patients in the Sonoma Valley? I mean, does the county have any estimated count of how many people here are suffering from this?
We try to get specific numbers from the health department, and their numbers are really old. So we don't have any current data on that. UCSF is actually helping us to collect some of that data, or they're collecting and helping us to get some of that information. All of our clients, I would say right now, we have 3 clients from Napa County, 2 from Marin County, 4 from Marin County, but all our other clients are saying are in the valley. And those people were people who moved, we did lose some people that moved out of county that were still seeing coming to the fire.
Well, that prompts another question. In other counties or communities, are there similar groups?
There are services being provided, but not in this fashion, where it's really, I mean, the one thing is we thought when we weren't sure if we were going to find space, we thought maybe we would do something like the Yulani Fund and just have identified practitioners in the community and send our people there, and they said, no way. We want to be able to come to one place where we're together. It's in that waiting room where the magic happens, when they're talking to each other about, oh, I just used this CBD oil, or, you know, the melatonin at this dose has really helped. So that was something that actually surprised us, because I thought, oh, this will be perfect. No rent to pay, the Yulani Fund's. That model's the way to go, and the clients here didn't want that.
And Terry, wasn't that what the research was about? Was the group effect?
Right,
so,
right. Okay. And that's
part of it. It would be great if you could send us the study.
It's supposed to come by. In fact, I just talked to Pam today saying, I want to be able to bring that to all 85 pages of each board member. She's like, you can't. She said the end of the month we'll be able to, and I'll make sure that each one of you get the findings of that research project.
Sure. Questions from
I found a new physical therapist. Thank you again so much. And thanks for having me.
Congratulations. Kelly, you are up.
English. Okay, so A couple updates. Actually, we got a lot done in the last month, even the holidays. The major focus, obviously, has been the five-star hospital and the map to get there. You'll see a presentation, I believe, next month from Danielle Jones, who shows the four areas of what, how we need to get to a five-star rating and where we think we have opportunity. Actually, we're not that far away, so which is really good news. We had the stroke ready program. We're just waiting on the credentialing of the teleneurologists, and hopefully that will happen by February 1st. But it's working with UCSF, and sometimes it takes a little longer than we're used to. So
is this going to be JCO approved?
Do what?
Is this going to be JCO approved program?
It's CIHQ approved. It's our accreditation agency, yes. And they'll be out. We've already put in the application.
They could be out any time, probably within the next couple of months.
So that means we will get the stroke patients. They will be bypassing us, so that's very important. I just have to mention our new medical director for emergency services. I've probably said this over and over again. Very impressive. And he and Dr. Kidd identified a lot of opportunities to improve the emergency. Our service is good, but we've been working on stabilizing the doctors and having basically a smaller panel of physicians who are here more often. Because we did end up with a number of physicians who were able to come over from Sonoma West when it closed, and they're doing really well. The Patient Access Center team, we are hopefully by the end of this year, we will have a way to be able to call one time and get everything scheduled and get access to your records. We have an opportunity. Many hospitals are now doing this as a best practice. And this is something that, it sounds very easy, but it's incredibly complicated. And we have a team of six people on that working on it. And we should get something done, at least in imaging, in the next 6 months. And we're actually going to copy Tahoe Forest. So Bill, when you talk to them about destination hospitals, I called that CEO and learned about all their work they've done in patient access. So, Dr. Kathy is here again. I don't know if you recall, she was a urogynecologist and went out. I had a baby and now she's back. We have Dr. Roche, who's a shoulder surgeon, also starting in March. And he is on all the occupational health medicine panels, which is hard to get on, so he will be able to take the referrals for occupational health here. And that will be local. We all know we were very pleased to get the Kaiser admits in December, because we do provide services to Kaiser when they need it. This is the first time, and it sounds like we got the majority of their patients. So they called us, we called back right away. They were mostly from Santa Rosa. Santa Rosa was the one that was mostly impacted. During their strike, they sent the patients out to lower their census. I guess I was going to mention pain management. What I was going to say is that the health center is going forward, and the board will see a packet this month. And once that's approved, then they have to go through the government as an application, and then we'll be able to have the pain management physicians in Summit. Summit Pain Management, is that what it's called? Summit Pain Management will be part of the health center. So Dr. Roscopoulos will be at the health center, and then Dr. Hao and Yang will be at our clinic, and all connected, and then we're going to market together. So we're very excited about working with the health center.
It looks like they're looking at versus as we're going to take, they're probably May or June.
Okay, yeah, I kind of figured 3 months would be too fast. Okay, so the reason we're in here is that
yeah.
good news. They're getting paid during the shutdown.
So far.
Yeah, we're talking about that. So the reason we're here in this room tonight is the Planning Commission is meeting. They're actually meeting on the south lot, and so we will be anxiously checking our phones to see if that is approved. That is the tentative map. The next step is design review, and then the final map, hopefully in May and June. I know more about development than I ever thought I would, because our town can sometimes, they share concerns. So we were talking about this earlier. some people would still think that we need to use the lot for affordable housing, but remember, when we went out for an RFP, that was considered, and they couldn't make it pencil, and the density wasn't there. So I don't think it is a lot for affordable housing. We are going to have 20% affordable housing as required. Specified and required, but not the entire lot. So that is one of the contentions right now that I think they'll hear about tonight. But they have met all the requirements for getting the categorical exemption from CEQA, and we should have approval tonight. The Planning Commission in Sonoma approving something is, I guess, doesn't happen as often as we would like. And I will say no more. I think that's it. The trends are looking pretty good. Except this basically reflects November, and November was down because of the holidays for some of the clients.
The question on the chart is very displayed. It's kind of confusing. It looked like you've got an event in the calendar year that, you know, starts in July.
Everybody's questioning
You know, the trouble is, it looks like things are going south. Actually, if you turn it around, you still have the green at the end. It looks like that's the direction you're going. Right now, it looks like you're going the wrong direction thanks to this chart. So I suggest maybe adjusting it so it's.
Do we have a board vote on this?
Again, I don't know Walter Springs is in Weathersfield, but I've never, I don't recall him talking about the neurosurgeon being who gets that.
We had a complex case, we go there.
But you're right, we skip to the highest level, probably. Okay. I'll find out if Lynn's thinking about it. And then Dr. Kidd's not here, she's chairing surgery, so I'm just gonna, hopefully you've got a chance to read the report. We tend to overlap quite a bit. She's fixing all kinds of things. And one thing that I just think stands out is that she had a rapid cycle PDSA on the medical director contracts, and she was able to, again, she's only been here 6 months, go through every physician contract, put quality metrics connected with them, and hold them accountable for meeting those metrics, and also reduce the amount of money that we paid for call and for medical direction. Did a great job.
Okay. So, any other questions on the experience?
Thank you. If you turn to page 23 of the package, which is the second page from the cover memo, look at the gross revenue overall payer mix. Medicare and Medicare Managed Care came in at 60.7% of our businesses. So it's growing. Medi-Cal dropped a little under 15%, and insurance is holding between 19% and 20%. Cash collections were over goal by 13,000, a little over 13,000. Days cash on hand, 9.6 days. Accounts receivable, 44.5 days. Accounts payable, 44.3 days. Again, I keep repeating, a lot of the vendors now are asking for payment on front, so that's why. And then going on to the financials themselves, which is page 28 of the package.
So, can I ask a question about volumes? So, the past couple of months, seems like ER volumes are
down.
Do you have any sense of what that's about?
You looked at it, yeah.
I don't think that I can identify anything specific.
I don't know if this matters, but from the billing side, the volumes down, the case mix, or the level of services is higher.
It's starting to trend back up.
It's starting to rain, but you're right, it was down big time in November.
Big time in November, yeah. It's sort of a low budget for the last quarter.
Yeah, we were at over 11,000 in 17, and in 18 we came in right at 10.
Are other hospitals seeing, you know, is the urgent care facility grabbing a little bit of that?
I think we can say, but I think that's something we need to look and investigate.
I've got a board meeting with CHA.
Yeah, just like that. Ask if, yeah, if somebody else is here.
There's no way, I guess, to find out whether Safeway is grabbing any volume.
Yeah, it's a telemedicine program, so there shouldn't be. Mark did a study, and I don't know if we shared it enough, but most of our patients are not the level 4 survives. They're sicker for our ER, and it should be ER patients.
Yeah,
so.
That's the only urgent care. I think that's the only urgent care.
I was going
to ask you. I know. I'm in.
And not much food this year, I guess.
It's been a simmering.
Yeah.
We're seeing little spikes of it, but.
Not like last year.
Not like last year.
Then going on to the financials, the volume, as you just noticed, was down in emergency room. And still nursing was down. We set the goal of 15 patients a day, but more than that.
And we were more than that. Why we're not making the same numbers.
Right, we did
yeah.
Well, no, we set it to 15.
Oh,
so we're not even making that.
No. I think a lot has to do with the criteria for admission. I think the community circle. Total gross patient revenue, $172,000 per expectation. Deductions was $123,000 better than expected. Net patient service revenue is $48,000 under budget. Dropping right down to line 21. Salaries were over budget by $176,000. One thing I did here, I took out home health, and the reason was is we kept it in the budget, but there's no expense.
We took it out.
But it was in the budget for salaries, but we didn't have any expense. So the salaries look better than they should have.
So you lowered the budget to what should we have?
You took it out the budget number?
Yes.
Well, we're still overspending.
We're overspending.
Right. And it sounded like it was still off.
The 113,000 was over salaries. 62,000 of that was for travelers, and some of that was for the skilled nursing registry.
Which we know is going to the rest, the emergency room?
Plus, there was skills training for the month for the nursing and we had nursing staff.
If we can give you a quick summary, a lot of it is rebuilding staffing in the ICU and the ER. We have two travelers in the ICU on night shift. They are now fully replaced with the fully deployed staff. We still have two travelers in ER, but we have had as many as four. One of those will drop off and we'll continue to have one probably through February. Then search had a traveler that has dropped off. So, and we're also orienting one full-time equivalent in ICU and two full-time equivalents in ER. So there's the registry cost, there's the traveler, the orientation cost. We also have a skills fair in November, which is a lot of productive time, non-productive hours. So all that is, it's going in the right direction.
And still recruiting one for a manager?
Still recruiting for an ED manager. As you've heard, we do have the IC med-surg manager, which is just a kid.
And then on purchase services, I've sort of budgeted about 44,000. Part of that have used pharmacy telemed due to staffing issues. And then cost, we use more expensive TV test this year. So that came in this month here. The net result is we had a loss of a little over 600,000 compared to a budget loss of 503. 96,000 worse than budget. Going on to the second page, after accounting for the GO bond activity and other activity, we had a $94,000 loss compared to a 16,000 budget loss. EBITDA was a negative 0.6 versus a budget of positive 2.2, and EBITDA, not including the restricted content, the EBITDA, that was a 1.7% negative versus 1.3 positive. That is your question, so I'm not sure.
So, are you excited to work?
Yeah,
some positive. A little bit of positive news. I don't have to check yet. But we put a fire claim in for the loss of business of more than 500,000. They hired an accounting firm to look, forensic accounting firm to look for everything. The forensic accounts came back with recommendations here and 5,000, less than $100,000 medical. I met last week with the insurance company and I agreed to the reduction. It made a lot of sense there. I put in money for overtime. They said, yeah, we'll save money for people. So they will give us 395 plus 100.
So they'll give 300.
They'll pay 395 insurance plan less than 100,000.
Less than 295.
So they don't have to check it. So.
Oh my goodness, you really stayed tenacious on that.
Thank you
very much.
The sale of the south lots we're going through. Any change here?
That's what we're waiting on tonight from the Planning Commission. So
do they take our space in the Senate?
Yes. Okay. Well, we don't usually meet on the second Thursday, so they have the second Thursday. Okay. Yeah, so we don't know if it's going to go through, but we expect that tonight's map will be approved, and then they'll be on to the next
step. One more piece of positive news. We've been accruing for AB 915, which is the Medi-Cal shortfall outpatient payment. We budgeted about $900,000 for the partnership. Already at $1.1 million, we should have had three. In the state, we budgeted for about $150,000, about $300,000. That'll be in July.
The 14 Kaiser patients will be
We're not allowed to do that. No, not yet.
No, we filed our data claims.
Right.
We have to.
No, the claims in, they haven't paid.
No, they shouldn't have paid.
I'm just asking.
Yeah, we're.
So we're all.
From our good friends, right?
Any other questions or finances?
I have a question that's non-financial but has a financial implication. One of the things I'm thinking of bringing up at the finance committee is why we now use both EBITDA and IBDA. And I think we've, for financial purposes, moved everything over to IBDA, right? So I was thinking maybe we could eliminate that one line of the EBITDA from using it for anything. But I want to get to finance. I just want to make sure that there wasn't any non-financial implications that have to do with it. Okay, good. I'll report back.
You want to do the.
Oh, yeah, or is it?
I think.
Oh, yes, right, yes, of course. Can you do the question?
Okay.
Well, I thought, no.
It doesn't.
Yes, so somewhere down a little bit further, Kelly, we have the finance committee worked in. There it is. So first of all, I'd like to give a little bit of background. Several years ago, we started a work plan to make sure that we covered all of the areas for which we had fiduciary responsibility for the hospital. And it took a bit to get them all together, but I think now we have everything in our plan. And if there is something that's missing, please don't hesitate to let me know about it. And so last year we had as complete as we were with current issues, and we completed everything on the work plan and have reported it pretty much to the board in various ways and methods. And so this is now our 2019 committee work plan for your review, and it's been approved by the finance committee, and we will proceed unless there are questions or other items to be added to it.
So the section reminded me something, I think I forgot. Does the board need to appoint a board representation of the committee?
I believe it's the chair.
I think it's already written into the.
We can look that up, but
yeah, I think
it's the chair.
It's the chair, yeah.
The chair.
You.
Yeah.
So I so not the chair of finance.
No.
So
it's already written into the charter of the finance committee.
Okay.
So you don't have to.
Okay. Good. Anything else on that? I actually asked Jane if she would do a quick update on this.
Can I just add one thing? Sure, this is the first time I think that you guys followed me to come to report. You have a report at finance?
Well, you have before. You had.
Yes.
Several years ago. That was part of the, when I was here. This is when you did it. But this came up separately from that. Because everyone seems to know what finance does, but no one's on the finance committee is very clear on what quality does. And so I said, well, why don't we ask you and your compatriot to come and talk about what you evaluated your quality committee and about where we can exchange information if you want.
Length of time?
15.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
But not until.
Mark,
yeah.
I'm planning it.
Yeah. Thank you. Update on the TIF task force. I don't know that we've had another meeting since our last board meeting. Our next meeting is scheduled for January 29th. We did that so that we would, by that time, have 3 months of financials. We have had difficulty maintaining the census. And you will recall that as part of the whole process, we strengthened the admission criteria to try and prevent patients that really did not have adequate or significant rehab potential because of reimbursement issues, complex reimbursement scheme for skilled nursing facilities. But we just had not had the appropriate number of really strong
10.9.
That's a two long term.
That was that seven.
And two of those are long term.
But I would two of those are long term issues that will be there to perpetuity. So we, but the other things that have happened is that we have spoken with a consultant group who actually has spent the last couple of days here, a different one than we used before. This is the group that reached out to you because they read the article in the daily news, the newsletter that comes. They are very impressive. And I think potentially will perhaps be sending us a proposal. So we will have that to look at.
Management.
That's right. They will be coming to the January 4 meeting. I believe we'll be getting a proposal hopefully next week.
The SIM task force meeting.
The SIM task force. We also, before we had a meeting with administrators of Parker Villa, and they have expressed some interest as well, and they will also be doing a presentation at the next SNP task force meeting. So I think there are some possibilities out there. Keep our fingers crossed. I think after the January 29th board meeting, we'll see how these two presentations go, and we can figure out when would be the appropriate time for another public community.
Which will happen before the March board meeting, what do you think?
I would think that it would happen before the recommendation comes forward, which would be at the March board meeting, right?
And we also have a request to make a presentation to finance committee prior to that.
Okay.
When's that?
Oh, February. Okay. And on calendar.
Before this board meeting, so that's the last.
Right.
You just let me know you are busy.
Absolutely.
Any other board comments?